Before we start the first discussion that will be introduced by each architect with a short PowerPoint presentation, please allow me to give an introduction and to draw your attention on two slides, which in my opinion embodies and captures all the three topics, the architecture of museums, pavilions and installations, in a very accurate fashion. What you see here is one of the six pavilions designed by Office Kersten Geers David van Severen, guest in the second round table, for their exhibition Silver Linen Interiors in the frame of the Biennale Intérieure Kortrijk in 2016, an important design fair in Belgium that actually will close this Sunday. Those monumental boxes, each 11 by 11 and almost 6 meters high, were installed along the principal axis of the fair and showcased interiors by six international architects, designers and artists. I too was invited to realize an interior. And now I have to do this. What appears here as an abandoned and unoccupied booth that gives off a somehow depressing atmosphere with unfinished rough particle board walls placed on an oddly white but black overpainted carpet next to a bookshelf, an empty table and some design chairs, bad copies of Arne Jacobsen's famous 3107 chair, all illuminated in a psychedelic red sphere, is a surrogate. Here, the basic infrastructure of a design fair booth, walls, furniture, and lights, has mutated into an installation in which the so-called functional elements are artworks, all made by the Austrian artist Heimo Zobernik between 1991 and 2012. The totality represents a spin-off of an exhibition that inaugurated 12 years ago a new art center in West Flanders. It showed back then a kind of meta interior in an existing villa compound exclusively composed with some 125 artworks by 30 artists that are now incorporated in this presentation by 18 images of the show, actually cut out pages from the catalog taken by the German photographer Johannes Schwarz. I guess that this interior can be read in many ways, as institutional critique, as a new decor, as a display without display, or even a meta museum space. Howsoever, it establishes an interaction of references at the intersection of art, architecture and design. It shows how much those disciplines can complement each other and how thin the borders are to distinguish them. One of the issues of today's conference is to discuss those distinctions and relationships between art and architecture and to find out how they meet, influence and even overlap each other. Among others, I will discuss with my distinguished guests, what's the museum of today? Is it a place for contemplation? Is it a magical box for social interaction? Or is it a self-fulfilling prophecy as an artwork on its own right? How is the architect intrigued or affected by art? And what is his role as a mediator? What is the impact of art on architecture and how much does architecture impact on artworks? Let me introduce now our first two panel guests to discuss changing typologies, the museum in flux. To my right, Simona Malvezzi, very welcome, founded in 2001 together with Wilfried and Johannes Kuhn, the office Kuhn Malvezzi in Berlin. public spaces and exhibitions are the main focus of their work as architects, designers, and curators. They realized the architectural design for Documenta 11 in 2002, the Flick collection in Hamburger Bahnhof in Berlin in 2004, which Simona will just present in a minute, or the Julia Stoschek collection in Düsseldorf in 2007, which has been nominated for the International Mies van der Rohe Award. This project she equally will present.
No?
The firm has designed the recognition of a number of contemporary and historical art collections and dealt as well with sensitive preservation issues for listed buildings such as the Museum Belvedere in Vienna, the Liebig House in Frankfurt, the Berggruen collection, and more recent, the Museum for Applied Arts, both in Berlin. Last year, the office won the international competition for the Insectarium in Montreal that is scheduled to open in 2019. Their projects have been shown in international solo and group exhibitions, including the 10th, 13th, and 14th Architecture Biennial in Venice, or the first Chicago Architecture Biennial last year. Here in Paris, they show currently at Solo Gallery their thought-provoking project, The House of One, an inter-religious building for Jewish, Christians and Muslims that is to be erected from on 2019. Is that correct? You hope so, yeah. Because they are collecting, no? It's a kind of, they are collecting money to erect that building, and which I think is also an interesting new aspect, how to, you know, create architecture. And a one-on-one scale representation of this very project is actually right now on view in the central hall of the 104. But, right, but I don't know where 104 is. So. Emmanuel Christ, to my left, founded together with Christoph Kantenbein their office Christ and Kantenbein in 1998 in Basel. After internationally acclaimed projects in London, Jalisco in Mexico, and Xinhua in China, Christ and Kantenbein continues to cement its reputation at home and abroad with numerous museum concepts. Among the designs most recently realized number an extension to Kunstmuseum Basel in 2015 and the renovation and extension of the Swiss National Museum in Zurich in 2016. Both of those projects Emmanuel will present this afternoon. Currently on the drawing board, as their website states, are housing schemes in France and Germany and an extension to the Wallraf Richartz Museum in Cologne. Christ and Kantenbein have been distinguished, among others, with the Swiss Steel Construction Award, Prix Acier, the Best Architects 14 Award, or the AR Award for Emerging Architects in 2009. Since graduating from the ETH Zurich, the Swiss Federal Institute of Technology, in 1998, Christ and Kantenbein have maintained a balance between their profession and academic involvement. They currently teach architecture at the ETH in Zurich and at Harvard University Graduated School of Design in Boston. I'm very happy that you are here. Please give them a warm welcome applause. Simone, I hand over the microphone to you for your presentation. Right afterwards, Emmanuel will present his two buildings. And I guess in about 20 minutes, we will start a small, less, well, you will see. Okay. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you very much. I will show you two projects. This is the Hamburger Bahnhof Museum in Berlin, which we extended. You see this red line was a new venue for the Flick collection. Friedrich Christian Flick lent his collection to the city of Berlin for more than 10 years. And he paid for more than 10,000 square meters for exhibition spaces. And you see, this is the Hamburger Bahnhof Museum. And the building actually chosen for the collection is this red brick ex-warehouse that we decide to keep it as a ready-made and to show it, to display it. And in order to do that, we cover it with a new skin, like a coat, where we put all the technical stuff in the ceiling. And actually, we copy Palladio, because what he did in the Basilica, it's an amazing project. The old Basilica was by him refurbished. And he made a new, completely new architecture by only doing, adding circulation spaces. So we copied it and we did the same. This is the ramp that we cover with a new facade and we create a corridor. This is the front facade of the warehouse and this is a black corrugated facade, the court that I was mentioned before. And by doing that, we double the circulation, like we create two parcours, one shortcut and one ensuite, giving many possibilities for curatorial approaches. And the inside is like a complete insulated space, but it is like nothing has happened. We create different light environment for like here a completely artificial light for this Radnoy Gram installation. And then also spaces with natural light, zenithal light. And actually this is a very interesting sculpture of Dieter Roth called Garten Sculpture. And it started in the 70s as a small sculpture and Dieter Roth added new elements each time it was exhibited in new venues. So it's an ongoing project. Now Dieter Roth is dead, and his son, Björn Roth, is continuing the work. And he was very happy to work here in actually, literally lived in the space. Was happy because the atmosphere was that of the atelier and not of a museum. And again, another space with a natural light with work by Kippenberger. And Franz West, you see this motorbike. The collector, the Flick, bought, was very proud of this brand new motorbike. And then asked for Franz West for a new artwork. And Franz West took the motorbike and threw it in a pond. So this is a motorbike covered by slime, I don't know in English, mud. Now this is the very close relationship between the collector and the artist. And it shows how the space is actually made by the artist together with the collector, more than architect. We have here Isa Gensing with Wolfgang Tillmans and Sarah Morris. And again, this is Dieter Roth after a few years with new added elements. But what is important here is that architecture is present but not visible, which means the space is free for the artist that could dominate it. I mean, you don't have technical details on the walls. It's everything is in the roof. This is not Nazan Tour installation. And then we left a part of the ex-warehouse untouched, without climate, for special installation like the Bruce Nauman tunnel here. And again, you see all the spaces as like ready-made. We just painted the brick, existing walls, and we just cleaned the floor. This is the base ground with Luke Timmons, and P. pylori wrist. Bruce Nauman again. And then we had a problem how to connect the museum, the Hamburger Bahnhof, with the Flick collection. And we decided to make a tunnel underground, but it was too expensive to get rid of the pipes in the ground. So we keep the form, the shape, but we turn it upside down and creating two windows like a seeing machine for the context. Thinking that the visitor could see the context before entering the new Flick collection. And this is like a paper animal biting the Flick. You see the black corrugated facade on the right and the untouched part with the red brick. This is now, the red brick is not there anymore. They destroy it because they need space, you know, for new architecture. And this is the inside of the tunnel with an installation of Robert Kurmirowski, which is like U-Bahn Station, an underground station. And this is one of the windows facing the new black corrugated facade. And the building chosen for the Julia Stoschek collection was a former factory, a listed building with many restrictions, which led us to two radical choices. And one was to keep the facade as it was, just renovated the windows, and the other one to reorganize the inside with a vertical movement from the basement to the top. In the top, we could add this glass box, which was accepted by the Heritage Office, like a logo and a signal for the cities. But again, we thought we didn't want to have this kind, nostalgic industrial archaeological mood. So we painted all the facade in an abstract color, which is white, and it can be used by the artist. Yeah, you see here this brick installation, video installation by Tony Arsler. So the idea is that the building could be used by the artist in each part. And then again, as I said, the vertical organization of the building started from the basement with a cinema, hosting here a movie by Doug Aitken, going up. And then we forced the vertical view, also destroying the floor between the second floor and the third floor, because we thought that the visitors could perceive what is up and could make the personal curatorial choice by compare the two artworks. And this is the top. You cannot recognize our intervention from the old existing building. Again, we painted everything in white to give this abstract mode. And this is a space, it's actually a private space of the collector, and it's also an event space. And the language, the material are the same as in the other two floors, because you can have this kind of installation like a Carol Bove you see in the picture. And then up to the terrace, the glass box, and the terrace, which is also, again, a kind of exhibition space with this dendrum installation. Actually, the Julia Stoschek collection is a video collection. So this is Monica Bonvicini. And the problem of the video is that the sound, you have the sound, you have the light. And so we build in the house like a new perimeter inside the facade in order to create an insulated rooms for the videos. This is again that Atkin. This is Olafur Eliasson and a work in situ. Oh, cannot go. But what is important here is the use of the soundproof walls, which allowed one work like this of Marina Abramović to be next to a very noisy work by Aaron Young. And what we did is like a kind of system of sounds and silence, which means between the rooms, we create like an in-between rooms where you can rest, also have a conceptual rest between the two works. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I mean, okay, I'll be short as well. That's promised, and we do it, and then we have a discussion. And but just maybe one thought. I was thinking, I'm showing two projects, but what is the architecture of a museum about? And about many things, of course. But perhaps one thing that is at the core, at least of our work, is that we try to find, let's say, an expression or a solution for the problem of how is the city, and we could almost say the world, related to the interior space of art or of culture. So, of course, architecture is a mediator between the city, the outside world, and the, let's say, the place where culture is presented or negotiated taken the space. That's what I just put at the beginning in order to show you two projects that are actually not they are both museums. This is the Swiss National Museum, as you said, Moritz, in Zurich, in Switzerland, the Swiss National Museum. And what you see here is a working model or an early model, not a competition model, but still an early state. And you see very clearly that it is a 19th century building complex, very rich, a bit strange. It is a composition of different styles of architecture, so the historicist period, late 19th century, reinvention of Swiss cultural identity, and then this also strange, somehow new wing in the park that we called the contextual counterpiece to the existing. So it is a very intimate interaction between old and new, a dialogue between past and present, and at the same time, it is, of course, a very harsh, let's say, contrast also. This is like the starting point for a dialogue on the level of urbanism, type, and architecture. I come back to that, and the second image here is a working model, actually really early stage working model of Kunstmuseum Basel. I mean, you know, Kunstmuseum Basel is an amazing collection, world famous, I might say, nothing to do with architecture so far, so I can't say that, a very important collection. If I give you one idea about the collection, it is perhaps the idea of continuity. It starts with masterpieces from the 14th century, and it goes on to today's contemporary art. And this is special. I'm not saying it is the only collection that is doing this, but compared to the Louvre, let's say, or many, many aristocratic collections in Europe and around the world, it stops at some point for political reasons, perhaps. Or then the modern collections, Museum of Modern Art, it starts basically with the 20th century. And Basel is based on this idea of continuity. Of course, there are many, many important artists missing, but I think it is a beautiful line, mainly through European history and culture. And I'm saying this because the idea of continuity, as you will see in a second, is also important to our approach for that project that is different. It is a museum, it is an extension, but you could say it is somehow a new museum next to an old museum. It's two museums, and they are standing there facing each other across the street. And the new is like the neighbor of its older self, we could say. A different type of relationship, still dialogue between past and present, if I put it to that reduced formula, and also still the question, how is the idea, let's say the global image of museums, and this is, I think, what we will discuss, how is this actually related to an idea of creating a relationship to the specific local context. So this is a manifesto for museum architecture that deals with the place, perhaps more than many famous projects that we all know from like 10, 20 years ago. Very similar also to what you are doing, of course. Okay, so I have nine images, three plans and nine images per project. That's the Swiss National Museum. I don't know what direction. You see the plan of the model that we just saw. It is a spectacular site next to the main station on the south, and then on the right and on the left of that museum complex that is now like a sort of a closed circuit. We have two rivers, and then we have one or two plans, and you can see that on the level of typological order, the new building is somehow creating a bridge that is connecting the two wings, the eastern and the western part of this existing museum. That in itself consists of different parts, as I said. And then you have a second floor that is actually under the roof, having the main galleries. And what you can read already from the plan is it is not necessarily invention. I don't really believe in inventions in architecture, but it is the intention to use the idea of a continuous space. It is not gallery by gallery, but it's quite an expressive hangar. It is like an industrial hall, but in a very free form. And from the park, it is visible, but somehow only partly visible, because there is a very strong interaction with the trees that also explains to a certain extent this zigzag form. So it's a concrete object that then opens a big sort of passage. It is like a bridge, I said. This is a connection again, between the park and the interior courtyards of the museum. And of course, this big opening has an impact also then on the interior of the museum. This is one facade, and you see clearly there are two types of windows. There is this fenêtre en longueur, that's the library, and the others are small windows that open, give light or view to the workshops in the basement, and some view for the visitors to look out. But that's one problem. I think if we talk about typology and museum, we will not necessarily talk about windows. But one problem is museums don't want windows. The black box or the white cube, however you call it. And here you see, I think, very beautifully in that image, how then this kind of rough sculptural object is engaging a dialogue, a spatial encounter between the old and the new. They are facing each other. And then in the interior, we find concrete again. So it is very basic in that sense. This is a stairs, and this is perhaps one of the main galleries that I showed you in the plan, with a ceiling that is showing all the technical infrastructure. So I'm saying it is nearly industrial architecture, and we can talk about that. What role does industrial architecture play in our understanding, almost conventions of art spaces? It is not an art space. It is a history museum, and there is art presented as well. But it is a sort of a mixed use, changing exhibition floor that we are presenting here. And this is just one shot of the current exhibition, which I like a lot, because our architecture is nearly no architecture. It is basic, and it is just the exterior form is creating the interior space. That are archaeological findings, Roman fragments of Roman architecture found in Switzerland that are on display right now. And I like, of course, how then the physical connection is made between the most typical piece of architecture, il Capitello, and the concrete wall. And this is another nice shot, because you saw the opening in the park. The result is a monumental stairs, like, you know, looks like a power plant or a dam or something. And here, that's the most, let's say, social space of the whole new wing. And on top, at the moment, there is a model of the Renaissance church from Todi, which is, again, a nice image, I think. As you mentioned, Moritz, when we are dealing with museums very often today, and you showed it as well, we basically dealing with existing institutions. That also means, as architects, we are working on existing buildings, and two-thirds of our time, of our passion, and of the money went into the existing building, in the reinterpretation of it. And also by doing so, learning from the existing building and trying to project it to a certain extent onto the new one. So I think designing new museums in a context like such is always reinterpretation, reading the old, trying to find your distance. I mean, we are now 21st century, but still there is a relationship, and this is what is at stake. And this takes me to the second, which is Kunstmuseum Basel. The plan here, I mean, you don't know Basel necessarily very well, and you cannot necessarily read the plan very well, I'm sorry about that, but what you understand is historical context, center of a European city. Here you understand better the Gris Clair is the two buildings that are here. The project on the left, the existing museum with a wonderful big courtyard and an even more wonderful small courtyard on the left, 1930s, classicist, making explicit reference to Italian architecture history, beautiful Palazzo Ducale and so on. So the proud idea of a classical museum making reference to the idea or the type of the palazzo as the treasure to preserve art. This is a strong statement, 1930s, 2016. And I think it is a quite successful museum, and we will talk about that. We know that since 1930s, there has been a Centre Pompidou and others. Still, we were interested, again, in that relationship. Also related to the idea of continuity to a certain extent, as I said. So on the right you see, on a very different plot, not rectangular, irregular, very compressed, very small, the new wing or the new building that is meant to be an extension. It is connected underground. This is actually the main typical plan. You see the site, how it is related to the two, I mean, this is the main roads and the bridge over the river here, so a very prominent position. And this geometry is actually giving the clue of the plan that is, you could say, classical type, two wings, like a butterfly. And the building in this plan is negotiating, let's say, the archetypal gallery, rectangular, well-proportioned. These are the exhibition rooms. And it is sort of the tension between the clarity of that geometry and the specific irregularities of the ambiguity of the site, if you want. And now I show you some pictures. This is a bad resolution, I realize. I'm sorry, but you see it at the end of that historic road. And then you see a former National Bank building in the front, early 20th century. Then you see the Basel Kunstmuseum, the Palazzo, and this is the new one. And you see that in the facade of the new one, there is maybe, here it's a different view from the back, the old one, the new one, and you see that the new building is echoing the architecture of the old, perhaps, somehow, because there are layers, there is a classical structure, although it is a bit washed out, it is bricks, and very massive somehow. This is a nice shot because you see there's different shades of gray. So there is a sort of a transition from more solid, more heavy, dark, almost like the time would already have left its traces, to the more bright and white to the sky. And then, of course, there is a freeze. Of course, no, not of course, but there is a freeze. And in that freeze, in the brick, is LED light. So what you read is actually a well-tempered play of shadow and light that is static, but that can change. It's like masonry that appears and disappears. And we find that, if I may say, symbolically important, because you could say, you know, this conventional image of the museum as an institution, that is the palazzo, somehow here merges with, I'm not saying high-tech, but with the aesthetics of, let's say, the information age. And we found that very important, that we understand in the end our architecture, this mediator between the world and the interior, the intimacy of the exhibition hall, also that this is expressed through this. That's a romantic view of the back. I know, I mean, I like Stefano Graziani, you know him very well, huh? He's a fantastic photographer. In the end, I realized you never really see the building, but that's, I mean, that's what we wanted, apparently. This is the central stairs that you saw in the plan, huh? The thing that is between the two galleries. It's a very vertical museum, it's like 30 meters tall. It's marble and gray render, like a sculpture. This is the main, let's say, lecture hall. With a beautiful work by Frank Stella, Damascus Gate. So we are talking here classic post-war modernism. There are skylights in the top floor with a work by Donald Judd here. It is the traditional gallery, I have to say. And this is the provocation and the proud statement, but also the risky statement in our times. There are well-defined rooms, committed space, as we called it, physical presence, the floor, the ceiling, so the materiality is present. We can argue, is it too present? Is it the idea of the sacred space of a gallery? I think that's what we should work about. This is Barnard Newman, so maybe this is not so wrong. The museum as a place of contemplation, you were asking. Yes, I think Basel, to a certain extent, is a proposal in that direction. Why? Because I don't necessarily think it's the only way of proposing a museum, but related to the existing museum, I think it's the most obvious one, that we insist on a quality that it's there, that makes the art experience in Basel different from the art experience in Paris, let's say. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
It is interesting what we saw, I think, because on one hand, Kun Malvezzi presented two projects where you exclusively deal with private collections. You presented two projects which are more related to public collections. You, in a way, both overlap in that topic of the collection, so that you had to design apparently a building very much focused on something existence, on a content that was, so to speak, known to you. Both you referred in a way to classical Palladian architecture with your two projects. I mean, in regard of the Flick collection in Berlin and in regard of the museum in Basel, indirectly. I think that is also interesting to see this at today, in this parallelity. Now, the topic, well, I said it was a bit at random chosen, is the typology. And when you make a kind of a short wrap up of, let's say, the past 50 years, what kind of marking museums they have been built. Let's think of, I don't know, Nationalgalerie in Berlin in the 60s, no? Think of Hollein's Abteimuseum in Mönchengladbach in the 70s. The Pompidou was also in the 70s, which was a kind of the museum as machine, which was certainly a pivotal moment. think of, I don't know, the monolith of Zumthor in the 90s maybe. That was also the time when Tate was initiated in London as the kind of, you know, the huge power station machine, you know, the museum as a power station, so to speak. Think of later on the museum in Kanazawa of Sana, museum of 21st century, which is a circle, which has a kind of an organization of agglomerations where the space is a city, and you literally get lost in it. Think of most recently, maybe, I don't know, the Broad in Los Angeles, which is a vault, you know, kind of something like Schaulager you have in Basel, but in another kind of defined. I was wondering if you, as architects, if you see a kind of evolution in this, you know, if you, or is that, do you read in putting those building typologies on a row in its own time? Do you sense a certain kind of logic? Do you have an idea in which direction that particular discipline of constructing the museum is heading to? Maybe Simona?
No, I think we are facing two different but parallel typologies. There's, we have an architecture which shows itself, you know, like the Bilbao, the Max in Rome, and this is also an historical, you mentioned the Borgia in Paris. It's a big size in the city. And then we have architecture which shows something else, which is art. So you mentioned the last 20, 30, 40 years, 50 years maybe, and we have the two, these two realities which are going parallel. And I think we have a big problem. There's a big gap between art and architecture. Most of the architect doesn't even know what contemporary art is. I mean contemporary art, but it's also from the 70s with a, like institutional critique. They think about art as sculpture or like Malerai, painting. And this is a problem because most of them dealing with art spaces, they don't know how to prevent the space to be too much visible with too many materials. And I think one of your questions was about how can architecture change art? It can change it. It can change the perception of an artwork and also the light. I mean, if you have like a yellow light, you can totally drop down the artwork. And also if you have a big, I mean, mix of materials, your perception is totally, I mean, not destroyed, but in a way confused. So we have to be very, very, stay calm with this definition on how art can influence architecture. And I think we are facing also many, many artists now dealing with different themes like architecture, design, sociology, philosophy. And there are many more artists that knows more about architecture than architect, which knows more about art.
I think that's correct.
That's correct. So, I read all your questions, but I found it very difficult to have an answer. But this is, I mean, the main point to...
You know, I think it is astonishing when you look at the, let's say, the mentality of your of the projects you have presented. So you could conclude it is very much site there is a site awareness. What you
no,
call
the, you
a,
can
a,
compare a, the, I mean the
an awareness for let's say a local characteristics. In the free collection, it's maybe very much related to the typology of the storage space, which it was. You know, it was originally it was a kind of
a warehouse.
A warehouse, exactly. Yeah, and in the case of Basel, Emmanuel, it is very much related to the old existing museum. I mean, like you described it as a cousin of it. If it is an old or a young cousin, we don't know. But
the Basel Museum, we called it a contemporary brother, which is of course a total nonsense, but it sounds somehow good. But I think to your question of the evolution or development of museum architecture and types, more specifically, I mean. I also feel, I totally agree with you, Simone. I think I feel tempted to say it came to a certain point. I don't know where it exactly ends, you know, the linearity. It also, maybe I should put it differently. I mean, looking at history, we need a minimal distance, 30, 40 years, and then things get clear. So what is happening right now, perhaps we should say we don't know. But what I think we can tell is that for a long time, period in time, the development of the architecture of the museum was related to a social political idea of making art accessible. I mean, this is like the Feindbild. That was like the problem was 19th century institutions for the elite of a bourgeois society. It is the palazzo, it is the so-called temple. Although Schinkel was the first one to offer a vision of a public space invading the museum remained a place that was pretty closed. And during then the modern movement of the 20th century up to the 1960s, for obvious reasons, and Centre Pompidou was opened in 77, but it's a 1960s project, clearly, was a radical change. I mean, taking down the barrier into the museum. Very clear political program. It goes on for a while, but it's not the democratic basic right of encountering art anymore. It is rather, let's say, the commercial power behind the idea of art that invades the museum. Tate Modern is a power station, socially speaking, politically speaking, economically speaking, of course. Huh? So, and somehow, parallel to that, I would say, it's a bit general, forgive me, but still, I think it's true. Art now, we don't have the problem of the kind of awkward 1950s anymore. I mean, art is omnipresent. There is too much art in the world. I mean, on a superficial level. I'm saying that as a provocation, don't misunderstand. But art is omnipresent. This is also fantastic. It's on the internet. So it's not that you want to know about that artist, but you're just not able to get there. You can find the information. So I could argue, that was a bit the argument for Basel, but I'm not claiming this as the one and only solution is, you must come up with different types of museums that are trying to create a very intense and specific, ideally unforgettable, unexchangeable art experience. Because I have seen that Barnett Newman. Was it London? Was it Tokyo? Was it Basel? I don't know. It is what makes it an authentic and a strong experience. And there, I totally agree. And I think we should be modest as architects or humble that it makes a huge difference. Perhaps this floor is, you know, many critics thought, I mean, basically architects tend to like the Basel Museum. Curators hate it. They think it is already too much. I think, come on, it's a little bit of a wooden floor. And it's still a box. Be cool. But already the material is there. Maybe it's a bit too strong. Who knows? So this is where we have to act. It's true. What I then always, I wrote the text, full manifesto. I said, you know, a decent piece of art, doesn't matter whether it's a video or a classical painting or even a performance, it has right to meet a real space. And the counter, let's say, the enemy is the art fair, of course. It's cardboard walls, it's all improvised. And I mean, it's such a kind of a transient space that I feel the relationship between the booth, the box, and the work is totally wrong. And in that sense, I'm a very fundamentalist. Anyhow, this is a little bit to that question. So there is, at the moment, there is no perhaps clear direction. But what I can say, and I think it's true, star architecture is over. The self-referential beautiful sculpture with shitty collection or no collection at all, with totally generic spaces. I mean, even good architects did really bad museums because the attention goes totally, it's the sensation of the object. And this is not.
Can you give an example?
I can.
It's interesting because there is
La Confluence in Lyon. This is okay, it's not art, it's a bit of everything. This is called Himmelblau. I can say, you mentioned it, Maxi in Rome. It's embarrassing, I have to say. It is embarrassing. It's fantastic discourse, the architectural part of it. I mean, I saw a wonderful show on architectural history, but the collection is weak, the spaces are horrible, and everybody finds it spectacular because it's written in the wallpaper guide that it's spectacular, and this is not enough. I mean, I'm here to entertain also, and to make you think and provoke. And I apologize if the director of Maxi is sitting here, we can have a conversation afterwards.
The problem is not the Maxi. I mean, the Maxi is okay, because it's a problem of representation. But it's nothing to do with art, because it's, I mean, I know artists that were showing something there, and they were totally, I mean, destroyed by the space. They didn't want to show, because the space is not for art. This is a museum thought for the cities. They wanted to renovate, reactivate but it was an abandoned area, so the Maxi was like Caserma Guidoreni, right? It's like Bilbao, no? It's a thing, a museum, yeah. A thing thought to reactivate something. Yeah. We had the same problem in Milan. There was a Libeskind museum, like, you know, a Torre di Babele. And it has not been built, but the problem was because there was no program, there was no content. But we have to think about what a museum is. It's not architecture, it's the program, it's then the cost that to maintain it. And so you need, I think museum can have to be done by artists. Like we have now artists which are curators. Now we have the manifesto curated by Jankowski. So we are.
Are you referring to something like, I don't know if you have seen it, talking about museum done by artists?
Yes, but
the Musée Albinet, I think it was called, in Aubervilliers by Thomas Hirschhorn, who presented, who constructed a kind of a temporary structure and presented, I think, weekly just one work, be it a Salvatore Dalí, be it Ferdinand Léger, all, let's say, temporary loans from the Pompidou, and, you know, created a kind of a didactic envelope around to offer let's say the experience, the beauty of art to a public who maybe not necessarily goes to visit the Pompidou. Is it that what you mean?
I mean, it's not a contradiction between the art or typology. I mean, we have this kind of museum made by artists, but we have the other kind of museum, which is the historical one, the institutional one. It was thought to let people know what art is, you know. And I don't see the contradiction, but you are not right. There are still many star architect heroes. It's full. I mean, it's not finished, the era.
Of course it's not. And then the very honest question would be, what do we think our generation, what is our secret ambitions? Do we want to be stars? We don't know, but perhaps we have to survive, but
yeah,
we make different architecture.
Just something you mentioned while explaining, so charmed, you know, by the Rothko you presented. Is it the idea, and it's equally the question to you, Simona, that you wanted, I mean, very simply said, to create a home for the artwork? I mean, yeah, you know, like a place where the artwork feels at ease?
Although I think this is a very, very beautiful, no, it's, yes, very beautifully put. Also, typologically speaking, it's like a big house. And we call the text the house for art,
mm-hmm. I mean, meaning a home. This is very banal. But
banal is sometimes, at least for a conversation like that, it's perfect.
But did that mean that in for both of you that you engaged yourself in the process of designing, be it, you know, with your budget, I think, which was very limited in the case of the Frick collection, which was maybe some less limited, in your case, but did you engage yourself in you know, with the artworks in order to define that concept of home?
Yes, I mean, first I also apologize for this. Banal is a theoretical term that is actually
very complex.
quite substantial. And it is important in our architecture, at least. And for the home, I mean, we did. I mean, I also have to say this is a bit strange. Huh? You were also in that competition. It was an international, really big thing. And in the end, it's sort of the local guys to happen to get that commission and to win. And I have to say, I'm really familiar with that museum. I didn't start to study it only when we start to work on it. So I know the collection, and there is a relationship. And that idea of home is maybe also somehow related to that fact that there is this this deep relationship. And I also have to say, in the case of Basel, we collaborated very closely with the director, who also was the curator, and his understanding of how to present art, this type of art, was very influential and was very present in the scheme, I have to admit. Huh? And I think this is this for the strong and maybe also weak parts of it. We shared really that, and it was this idea, perhaps, of the home that came with the place. It's true.
Did you have that experience as well, Simona, with Mr. Flick in
No, I want to mention
concept.
The Documenta.
Yeah. Yeah.
Documenta was a competition that we won, and our competition was and our project was about parkour and not rooms, because it had to be very general. We didn't know which kind of artworks there were going to be. There were more than 100. I was saying 1,000, 1,000 artists, not 1,000 is too much, no, 100 artists. So we had to be very general, but at the same time very specific, because we had to think about all the media, like photography, sounds, and so on. So our project was about the circulation again, so this idea of Palladio, the corridor, so something that could define the relation between art and architecture, because we did like home for the artist, which was very free, and the rest was like circular space. All the exhibition became a city model in scale 1:1. And yeah, again, it was really clear how the difference between art and architecture, because architecture doesn't make object but spaces, functional spaces, and all the corridor. I don't know if you have been to the Documenta at times, was in 2002, and so like it were like square and street. And this was our.
Well, you had you established two circuits, you know, an official one and an individual one,
again, the visitors the possibility to combine his own experience, time experience and narration.
We have almost talked an hour. I will just have a quick look at all of you. Is there any questions to our two fantastic guests from your side.
Thank you very much. I'm not sure if it's a question or an observation, and I have to admit I came in more than halfway through this. But as a user of spaces in the double sense of someone who goes to exhibitions, but also who exhibits, I inevitably think about the museum or gallery spaces, which I find very satisfactory, and why. For example, Louisiana Museum to the north of Copenhagen by Jürgen Bow 55 years ago or more. And what's so marvelous about it? It is serenity, is beautifully related to the surrounding landscape. It has a promenade, but it also has places to pause and reflect. It can receive large works, small works, intermediary works, and it can receive installations. It's also a place where people quite simply like to go because there's a good restaurant, which is an important part of it. Or Kimball Museum, almost the same period, by Kahn. Now, what's so marvelous about that building? Initially, when you see the plan, you think this is a highly rigid, over-organized museum. You go in and you find great fluidity of space. Of course, you find magical daylight as something which draws you in, which transforms your experience, although the works need, like most museums, a mixture of artificial and of daylight. And so to me, it's obvious we're in a period of schizophrenia between, you know, very exaggerated shows. There happens to be one quite near the Bois de Boulogne, for example, on the point of opening, which has no relation whatever between this pantomime of structure, the way it stands up, and the rather boring spaces underneath, architect Gehry. Actually banal exhibition spaces, which don't even have that peace and calm. So there we are in, I think, a highly problematic realm, which has been explored a great deal, and I'm sorry to say I wasn't here to see your own works, which are clearly nothing to do with that. But what one wants is, at a certain point, an architecture, the art of architecture is to make the art of architecture disappear. It's to enhance experience, to open the mind and the senses, but at a certain point to withdraw, and then at other points to come forward. And obviously it's about the revelation of the site. If one were to talk about near Basel, the Baila, for example, which maybe is Renzo Piano's most interesting building, an architect for whom I have profound disrespect for the way he destroyed Le Corbusier's Renchamp, but that's another issue. But what's good about Baila is how well it goes into a not quite urban situation. It has a landscape, a historical context, and then you have the fields, and he allows you to breathe. One of the big problems for me of Tate Modern, which I know perfectly well, is that you don't have enough places to breathe. Also, the rooms are of very poor proportion, the lights are far too high, and Mondrian disappears into darkness, and big problem of all, the route is on a diagonal. So there's always collision between movement and pause. So if we talk about typology, because that's what you're really talking about, it's not just patterns and forms of organization. Is getting into the very heart of what the program of a museum means and how do you articulate those basic human situations. And one final observation, the installation itself is terribly important. Pompidou is no longer Pompidou. It's actually a series of partitions, rather well done, in my opinion, for the Museum of Modern Art, but it's nothing to do with the container. I recently, if I may, excuse me, had a large exhibition of my own paintings inside the palace of Charles V in the Alhambra. It's a royal palace of the 16th century. It's not made for art, it's very difficult, it's very big, but we established, I think, a wonderful secondary scale that's very calm within a building which is almost impossible. And yet we responded to the setting. So what is a museum? It's a place where other kinds of interventions occur to bring the whole thing alive, but hopefully without being crushed by what exists there already. It's all about dialogue and enhancement, really. And I'm very sorry I didn't see you both. Perhaps later I can look at them. So there's some thoughts.
Thank you very much. You are absolutely right. And that is this, that it is a dialogue, art and architecture. And there is not such a thing like, you know, the ideal museum or the ideal artwork. what happens is the encounter of the two and the condition of that very encounter. And it is not necessarily even the art museum which is the best museum. I mean, for me personally, I saw a historical natural science museum in Stockholm. Is for me the most fantastic museum I saw, and that's not art at all. But it is, I think, this great moment when you encounter art or when you encounter architecture depends on many, many, many circumstances, on your own mood, on the weather, whatsoever. Well, what is sure, it's an endless discussion. And unfortunately, we have to stop it. Thank you very much that you made the effort to come to Paris for this little informal chat we had. Simona, thank you, Emmanuel. We continue in about, I would say, 10, 15 minutes with the second round table to discuss the phenomenon of the pavilion architecture. Thank you very much and hope to see you back.